Okay, so what we're going to do, I'm going to just give an intro. Then Mary is our fearless leader, experienced Cuba travel organizer, going to talk about what is needed to travel to Cuba. Then we'll go over the itinerary of our proposed trip. Mary will talk about the cost of the trip and what's needed to enroll. And then we'll stop for questions, and we hope everyone will have a lot of questions. And then, if we are still in the mood, we'll talk about fundraising guidance. So that's what we have to lay on you. MAPPA did an exploratory trip to Cuba in 2022. We took 10 of our members and leaders. Actually, we got there 2 days late due to weather related travel delays, but we were there for 6 days. We, had meetings morning to night with everybody from the foreign ministry to the local PTA and the local doctor, and we got a lot of information on Cuban society just in 6 days. So our goal for this one is to take a larger trip. We have it targeted for 24 people. We want MAPPA members. We also want people that MAPPA works with in various walks of life, in various coalitions, in various combinations. We think advocacy to end the embargo in Cuba is a critically important issue. Our relationship with Latin America is a critically important issue. So partly, we're just interested in solidifying ties with people and giving them more information to work with us on that problem. The second real goal is we want to compare the way Cubans organize with the way the American left organizes. So we want to speak or as organizers to organizers, exchange lessons, build connections, and hold our own practices and approaches up to a comparison. So that's basically what we have in mind. We're hoping to limit it to Massachusetts. MAPPA is a little bit in a funny position. We're a state affiliate of Peace Action. We also kind of acquired a national webinar audience over the last 3 years. So I think a third of our members now live outside of our state. So we have to figure out, if we kind of don't fill up our trip with people from Massachusetts, we might start recruiting from around the country, but we still want it to be people that we're going to work with, or people we are working with. So that's basically what we have in mind. Mary, do you want to go into the travel stuff?
Sure. Traveling to Cuba is regulated by the US government, the Office of Foreign Assets Control. And basically, what that means is under the Trading of the Enemy Act, Trading with the Enemy Act, you cannot spend any money that you have acquired while being a permanent resident or citizen of the United States in Cuba, except by special permission of the Treasury Department. It's not a visa. Only the country that you're going to can issue a visa. It's a license, in this case, a general license. So we will be traveling under those regulations and we'll all sign a travel affidavit that's provided by the tour operator and the airlines. There's nothing more to it than that. And we will be ensuring that we're in conformity with the regulations, which basically mean that you can't do anything that's considered tourist, like we can't go to the beach, right? But so that's what will be covering us legally under the US regulations. And then to travel to Cuba, all you need if you are a US citizen is a passport that's valid 6 months beyond the date of your return, in other words, through June, and that's an international regulation. And then Cuba issues something called a tourist card, which is just an entry card. And that also will be supplied as part of the arrangements we make. Cuban-born participants, and we may have a couple, they need some different paperwork. They need a Cuban passport. If they came in a certain year, they travel with a different kind of visa. But that's also easy. And that's basically it. So as long as you know what you're doing, you can travel to Cuba. And that means that you have to be going with people who know what they're doing and will guide you, and we will. And so if you get questioned when you come back, as people from time to time are, you'll have plenty of evidence to show that you have traveled to Cuba legally. That's it. People can ask questions about that again during the question and answer period if they want to. So I'll go on to the itinerary if people are agreeable. And would it be helpful for me to share the screen for people to see it?
Well, I shared it, but if you want to change it, Mary, that's fine.
You shared it quite small, so why don't you stop? You stop sharing, and I'm going to share it.
Why don't you make your window bigger? Then it would not be small.
I'm gonna. Mine, I think, is going to be bigger for everybody.
I can see it just fine. It's my full screen.
Okay. Well, I can't see it. So.
Why don't you share yours, Mary? Then you'll be able to see it.
Okay. So basically, this program is full of things. Basically, the goal of the program is to look at peace, social justice, and environment in Cuba. As Cole said, what can we learn from the way things are done or aspired to in Cuba that will help us understand our own work and will give us insight both by seeing how other people do it and by the interactions among us as we see and explore what Cuba's doing. I think it's pretty explanatory. We're going to do a combination of meetings and visits that will try to address the content of the title. The Fidel Castro Center is just a treasure trove of information, not just about Fidel, but what Cuba has done over the decades and decades. And it's quite interesting. We're also going to go to a baseball game if there's one on. We'll see. And baseball game, I'm one of those people who think watching baseball is like watching paint dry. But I have to tell you, a baseball game in Cuba is very exciting by what goes on in the stands, which is brass bands, people dressed up. I mean, it's just a thrill. Then we'll go on to meet with the Cuban Institute of Friendship with the Peoples, who are in effect our hosts. And that is an organization that was formed in the very early 60s with branches in every country on all of the continents. And it's quite an interesting and knowledgeable place. And they are a great place to ask questions about anything you want to know, both nationally and internationally. And that's that. We're also going to have a meeting to talk about what's going on with the Cuban economy, which is quite in crisis, and to see what they think about how they're going to get out of it, and this out of their current economic straits. And this is where we also will be thinking about the impact of our own policies, and most specifically the U.S. embargo and the presence of Cuba on the list of state sponsors of terrorism, which is what prevents Cuba from any normal banking or other kinds of trade relations. I also want to build in some fun for us. And last year when we were there, we discovered a place called the Blue Moon, which is run by a Cuban and an Italian. And you know, they have this portico that sort of has drapes against the sun and comfortable places to sit. And they serve tapas and drinks. And we're going to see if our friends Alberto and David Faya can take us through what they do, which is a history of 500 years of Cuba through its music. Then Last year, we developed a relationship with an elementary school. We took them supplies and we met them, and we had meetings with some of the teachers, and we used their classroom for meeting with community people. And we will do that. Also, we want to meet with university students, which was something that we wanted to do last year and didn't. And then from there, we're going to go to La Timba for the Marti Community Project. So, Michael, I don't know if you remember that I'm actually trained in community planning. And I've worked a lot in Cuba with people who do community organizing and community planning there. And this is one example. Wait a minute, this is Paul Shannon. Let me just see what he wants. Paul? Okay, I'm gonna have Cole take care of it because I'm going through the itinerary.
He's got the wrong number. I'll tell him I'll send him the number.
Okay, he's going to send you the right one. Thank you. Bye. Bye. So there's two kinds of community. There's several kinds of community organizing that goes on in Cuba. One is, as we learned last year in a meeting, which we'll also have this year, with people who are actually leaders in the neighborhood in which I live when I'm there, is there are these kind of concentric circles that all sort of nourish each other and make sure that the community is taken care of. And we will meet with them. And then there's also these, they're called community workshops that are sort of like little mini CDCs. And then there's this new project that comes out of that, which is to try to take communities that have been neglected and build them up. And that's La Timba and Marti. And this will be a very special visit for those of us who are interested in community planning and community organizing. And as you see, then we'll go on to meet with the local leadership in the neighborhood of Nuevo Vidalo, which is where the school is and where I live, and meet with people who are responsible for trying to implement the Cuban social project, and which includes care for people and lifting people up and involving people. Then we're going to also visit a polyclinic. Cuba's organized so that there's a family doctor for every 350 families, and then a polyclinic for every 10 to 12 of those clinics. Which I don't know, it could be compared to the Upman Community Health Center, I think, though it has more specializations, like you can get x-rays and stuff there. I also have planned a meeting with the Afro-Descendant Women's Network, which is a group of kick-butt women who are very good friends of mine, who really have a handle on anti-racism, feminism, and cultural movements. And then we'll go back to the Blue Moon, because there's nothing like sitting around drinking good drinks, eating tapas, and talking to interesting people. We also have a meeting with the Ministry of Foreign Relations. We have quite good relations with the foreign ministry in MAPA. We hosted their ambassador in Boston a year ago, June, and have good ongoing relations with them. And this is a chance for us to talk directly to them about what is going on in U.S.-Cuban relations. I also have planned a visit to an organoponic garden. And I think it's very interesting to see what people are doing in urban gardening. And also, Cuba has a whole national plan to address the climate disaster that takes in every single aspect of addressing climate change and climate resiliency. And we'll meet with them, and or we'll meet with people who are working in solar energy. They have a plan to have the whole country on alternative fuel, for both climate reasons and practical reasons, which is they don't have access to oil. But they're held back by their inability to get the resources from abroad that they need, even in terms of raw materials, to be able to do it. So they're making progress, but it's slow. You get a night off. Then there's this presentation from this ministry that I talked about a minute ago. And then I have in mind that we will go to Cienega Zapata, which is this biosphere and national park that is the home to people who used to be very poverty, very impoverished charcoal workers. Claire has her hand raised. Do you need to interject something, Claire?
I can wait. I just want to, after you finish this little piece.
Okay. And last year, we met with the station agent there for CITMA, this environmental agency, and they talked about how they're involving local communities to work with them in their work to preserve endangered species and of both animals and plants. And what I'm hoping for is that we can stay in one of these communities. This is a community that's also developed this incredible cultural project, that we can stay with them overnight and then do a few hours of voluntary work with them. That's our hope. And then we'll come back and we'll have a party inviting people that we've met, and then we'll go home. So I can stop sharing and see what Claire wants to.
Well, I just thought, you know, it's for people who haven't been to Cuba. I mean, I only went this one time in 2022 on this short trip because our flights were delayed and all that stuff. But I think it's just so much information. Sometimes it's challenging. But in particular, I don't know how much people know about the state sponsors of terrorism, but that is not an international thing. It's a U.S. imposed, U.S. created designation that we put on countries. It is not like it's a legit. I mean, I don't think it's a legitimate designation. So that's one thing I wanted to clarify. And other than that, I don't want to hold up. I think there should be room for other people to have questions.
Right, right. Well, we'll get to questions for sure.
What I'll say then is sometimes it's a good idea to ask if there's any questions at this point and then to go on because so much.
Okay, why don't we stop for questions right now?
And welcome, Jared.
So I have a quick question. It goes back to what you were first saying about the tourism aspect of things. Are we not allowed to buy little souvenirs or anything? Is that part of the limitations?
You are allowed to buy souvenirs.
Okay. But we just can't, like, you know, do the touristy thing, like go to a beach or a national park or anything like that?
You can go to a national park for sure. You can't just go sit on the beach.
You can go to museums, you can walk around Old Havana, which is extremely interesting. It's a, you know, 16th century Spanish colonial architecture. It's a thing of its own. But,
and I actually am an expert in U.S. regulations and even sometimes figure out how people can go to the beach.
Tourist. How about the language? I don't speak any Spanish. It's pretty good there with English.
No, I wouldn't say that.
Everybody tries to speak a little bit of English, but basically we're going to have a full-time guide with us who will translate. Mm-hmm. And I'm fluent in English and Spanish. So it's not a problem if you don't speak Spanish. It's really not.
Yeah.
And the other thing about it is that people go out of their way to be kind and friendly. So you'll never feel put on the spot.
Yeah. How many people do you think will be joining this tour? I mean, is it just the people on this, or is there a lot more people? Kind of small.
The trip is based on 24 people.
Okay.
But that doesn't mean we've recruited 24 yet. We're still recruiting.
Right. We're in the early stages.
It's about $2,000, you said?
The trip is estimated to be, based on 24 people, 2030.
Okay. And we pay our own airfare to boat Florida.
And then you pay the airfare, tips and gratuities, and other kinds of personal expenses.
Okay.
The meals that are included are the ones that are listed in the itinerary.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Which I think you will have received a copy with. There's a link to it when you go to sign up, and we can always send you another copy.
Yeah, I have a link to the itinerary. Thank you. The document for that, Cole sent it to me. So.
Yeah,
the flights are going to be through Florida. You fly from Boston to either Miami or Fort Lauderdale, and then on to Havana.
Yeah.
You know,
there's been a slight...
American Airlines or Delta, you know.
There is a hitch in the flights, which is that I thought we were just going to get on JetBlue, make a stop in Fort Lauderdale and keep going. But JetBlue has canceled other flights to Cuba. And the other airlines that fly commercially have restricted their flights. So American is still flying some days, which means going out of Boston, no problem. And then there are charter flights from Miami that sometimes are a little pricier. So, you know, the airfare could end up being more like $650 or so. We'll just have to see. What I always say about Cuba is it's like the New England weather. If you don't like it, wait, it's going to change.
So would we all meet up at one of the airports, then fly over together to Cuba on the same flight? So we just
absolutely.
Have to... Okay,
absolutely.
Yeah, sure. Cool.
The preference is that we all meet up in Boston and fly together. So that, you know, everybody's together facing the same things and getting there together.
Sounds good.
And same thing coming back.
And if there's a real reason where somebody wants to tack another city onto the trip or something, you know, you don't absolutely have to fly from Boston, but that would be, I'm sure most people will do that.
Right. In fact, last trip, somebody was coming from Texas. And in fact, theirs was the only flight that wasn't delayed.
Mm-hmm. They were the only one that saw the baseball game as a result.
Well, me, I saw the baseball game.
Yeah, you were already there.
But I think of baseball as watching paint dry.
I agree with that.
Are there other questions about the itinerary?
Can I talk a little? I went, Mary, in 1982 with a group from, they were architects, planners, and urbanistas. And I was the oddball organizer with the group. It was an amazing experience. Were you on that? Did I meet you there?
Who, me?
Yeah, I don't remember you.
Oh, no, I never have gone on those kinds of trips.
I think it was Jill Hamburg had somehow been involved.
Yes, with Jill Hamburg, who I'm still very good friends with.
Okay. Yeah, I think she had something to do with organizing it.
Yes. Yes. Wasn't it through the Planners Network?
It might have been. And it was some center in Manhattan that was organizing educational trips that were allowed still, even though Reagan had just been elected.
Yeah.
And I remember meeting this guy who was a brilliant, he ran three think tanks in Cuba around housing and urban policy. We had a lot of interesting coverage. He was like completely fluent with the literature on Eastern and Western European housing.
Are you thinking of Mario Cuyula?
I don't remember his name. This was 40 years ago. I'll look it up. But it was a really interesting guy. If he's still around, I would...
Mario has died, but stick to me, Michael. That's who I'm connected with in Cuba, is all the planners and architects and community organizers.
Yeah, well, we did a lot of things. Like we had a tour of urban renewal projects. It was very interesting to
compare. Well, that was before the Group for the Comprehensive Development of the Capital started, which I'll talk to you about at another time because it's really interesting.
Okay. You'd be really interested. Good. In it. Yeah, no, this would be great. Plus, years later, I was on the board of the Habitat International Coalition.
Mm-hmm.
There was a guy from Cuba who was on the board with me at the same time, and I don't remember his name. Mm-hmm. But he's might be worth trying to touch base with him. That was around housing rights.
Housing has changed drastically in Cuba over the last 20 years. And it's another thing that we can talk about at another time.
Yeah, okay.
Brian has his hand raised.
Sorry, I could probably answer this question myself, but I'm on the phone, so it's hard to take a look at that itinerary. Were you planning on day tripping Sianica or staying over one night?
Well, my hope is that we can stay in Corrimacao, which we were supposed to go to last year, but we didn't. But the hope is to be able to stay over. To be able to do that, we actually have to bring the food that we will need. So we'll bring food for us and our hosts, and we're still working that out. But the reason I'd like to stay over is so that we can do a few hours of voluntary work with them. It won't be very strenuous. It'll be, you know, saving the baby trees or saving the baby alligators or something like that. Did you go to the Cienega, Brian?
I did. We went to the, we went through it and then stayed at Playa Girón. We did stop at the Bay of Pigs Museum. But I must say it was, there was an outage in power. So the museum was tough. It was very, very hot, but you know, they're dealing with a lot of outages, as you well know.
Yeah.
So that's one thing that was, I guess, good to experience. And I think as a result of the outages, the stars were just the most amazing stars I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah.
Did I just hear you say there was a lot of power outages in Cuba?
Yes.
Yeah, that's right.
Cuba has some of its own oil. They finally found oil, but it's a very heavy oil that is not very good for the machinery. They were getting a good supply of oil from Mexico at one point a long time ago, and then they were getting a good supply of oil from Venezuela. But given the sanctions, they've had trouble getting it.
Yeah.
And on top of that, one of the problems is that given this state terrorist list that we've talked about, they can't get spare parts for their aging power plants. So there's quite a bit of trouble getting electricity.
When I was in North Korea, the same thing happened. The power was constantly going out. And as one of the consequences of that was the pumps for the plumbing, including the toilets, would not work. And so you would have sewage flowing back into the bathrooms on a regular basis. It was quite messy in some places.
That's not a problem in Cuba. They don't have the same kind of sewer system. So, no.
Yeah, on a trip.
And if we're staying in a hotel, it's not going to be an issue anyway.
In our trip a year and a half ago, we did not have power outages. Other comments or questions?
Mary, I remember an art shop in the museum square in a basement corner, and picking up prints of great Cuban paintings. There were like 10 in a package, and I gave them out as gifts when I got back. Is that place still around? I want to go back and get some
more. Another package.
I don't know if that place is around, but there's plenty of places to acquire art.
Okay.
One of the problems in Cuba is that anybody who wants to can go to art school. And I have to say, it's the country with the most bad artwork I've ever seen. But it also is a country with great artwork and great reproductions of artwork. So basically, finding art in Cuba is never a problem.
Can I say something?
Please do.
Well, I just think it's, I know for myself, you know, having gone last year, it's such a different society, you know, and how it's organized and all. And people are, you know, really struggling because of the blockade and because of the state sponsors of terrorism thing that blocks, you know, their ability to improve things. So, for example, the being able to just have enough food. And to, like Mary was saying, they want to, we went to presentations where they were talking about all their plans for how to get off of the fossil fuels and how to build a green infrastructure. They can't do it because of the blockade and especially the state sponsors of terrorism. So this is a terrible thing. And it's a terrible thing for the Cuban people. It's hurting the Cuban people tremendously. And they really don't deserve this. But, you know, when you're walking around there, you feel as safe, so safe. You're not worrying about anybody coming out trying to attack you or anything. It is a very different environment. So I'm just saying it's really worth going and experiencing it yourself.
Thank you, Claire. Should we move on?
Just to second that really, really quickly. I was just in New York City for the weekend. I felt way safer in Cuba. Like, not even close.
So I'll give you an example. When my daughter was a teenager, I used to let her go out to whatever hour she wanted and come home on the bus. And I slept like a baby. That to me sort of sums up. And I've never been anywhere in Cuba that I haven't felt safe.
Reminds me of
not just that. It's not just that. It's people's attitudes. I mean, you feel like you always can call on people and count on people. And that's very nice. Anyway.
Reminds me of Israel and Palestine. I felt much more comfortable and relaxed in Palestinian areas than I did the Israeli areas. Mm. Went there with Steve Lowe and Gralta Foundation back in 2017. Cole hooked me up with them, and it was it sounds similar. It's much more laid back.
Yeah. Should we move on?
Yeah, let's move on.
So we covered briefly the cost of the trip. I want to say that it is based on 24 people. If we have fewer people, then the cost will have to increase because we'll have fewer people. And things like buses and guides and stuff like that, things that that are part of a collective or group cost, get divided by the number of people who go. Similarly, if we all of a sudden turn out with 32 people, the price could conceivably go down a bit. We'll have to see. But as I say, I think that the airfare cost, given what's just happened, is probably lower than we can expect to pay. I think we can expect to pay between $650 and $700, I'm sorry to say. But this is a situation that's beyond our control.
Are you open to me asking some of my old colleagues at the State House if they're interested in joining us on the trip?
Well, absolutely, because I intend to ask some people too, like Marjorie Decker has gone many times to Cuba when we had a sister city in Cambridge. And she may be interested. Absolutely. I think it would be great if other people came.
All right. I have a few I'm interested that would open-minded enough to do this.
Yeah, definitely anyone who's an elected or even former electeds or, you know, people who are like mayors, city councilors, those are all the types of people that we want to right. have experience and
part I don't of. Know that it's the type of person that we don't want to include. Right?
Trumpers.
Plumbers, yes, we want plumbers.
No, no, Trumpers. Trump, Donald Trumpers.
Well, no, I have to tell you.
Who do I deal with them?
Not at the place where I live in Cuba now, but where I used to live in Cuba. There was somebody who was a Trumper. This was during the time that Trump was elected, who came to Cuba every year. He was a businessman from Detroit. And I said, well, why do you come? He said, because I like it here.
Well, there you go.
But I don't think he would be traveling with us. But anyway, so that's about
Mary Ellen has her hand up.
Oh, Mary Ellen, thank you.
Yeah, so Mary, could you remind us of the deadlines? Or I'm sure you were going to bring that up, but remind us of the deadlines. And I have another question, but it has to do with fundraising and funds, so I'll hold that off.
Okay, so that's the next item on the agenda, which is the first deadline is October 10th, which is with a deposit of $50. That's so that we actually know there's enough people to go ahead with this trip. Because there has to be enough time to plan and confirm everything. That $50 is non-refundable unless, for some reason, the trip doesn't go ahead. So it is in your interest to recruit other people to come with us. Because we do need to get to 24 people by October 10th. The second deadline is a $200 deposit by November 1st. That deposit will actually go to the tour operator, which is Marisol. Marisol has been in business since 1978. And they are very reliable, have been doing this a very long time. They're very good. And the deposit to them is non-refundable. Then final payment will be due December 6th. Now, I don't have from Marisol their terms and conditions. I can only go by what I used to do when I had a company that did this. But basically, up to, say, 45 days before you go, you get a certain portion back if you cancel and not the rest of it. Up to 30 days, another portion back, but not all of it. And then it gets to the point where it's entirely non-refundable. So that's why we've set the deadlines the way they are so that people can be very sure when they put up $200 that they really can go. And the other thing that I would say to people, and this stood me in good stead just a year ago when I was planning to go see my sister and I couldn't go because of a cancer. And I had to cancel and the airlines wouldn't give me back my money, but my travel insurance paid me. So I encourage everybody to get travel insurance and we will give you the names of companies that we know are reliable. You pay maybe, but I paid something like $190 and it's worth it. Do people have questions about this part?
So Mary Ellen and Jared have their hands up. Mary Ellen, is that an old hand?
Sorry, it's an old hand. I will take it down.
Hey, Jared.
Hi, everybody. Sorry, I'm driving right now, but I'll keep my question quick. So I was lucky enough to be on this trip last year with Mary and Cole and Claire and everybody, and it was fantastic.
You were lucky enough to have you.
I was very fortunate. My question is, I really want to go again, and I'd love to go back to Havana and the surrounding area, and I really like this itinerary. I'm just curious how much more time or cost there would be if we did the eastern part of the island, specifically Santiago and Guantanamo, what that would look like. Thank you.
We thought of that, doing an extension, and there may be people to do it. It'll be a few hundred dollars more.
So you're thinking of almost of sort of an optional extension into the following days to go to the eastern part of Cuba.
Right. It used to be, and may still be, that you could fly American Airlines into Havana and home from Santiago de Cuba. With all the commercial airlines changing and canceling, I don't know if that's possible. So you could potentially have the cost of getting there and then getting back to Havana. But it's certainly something to look into, and it's certainly something to do. And I think more than one person interested in that.
Is that a possible extension on the end of the trip, or is that a whole other trip entirely?
On the end of the trip.
Okay, but we can look at that if enough people are interested.
I mean,
Jared, there's no reason you can't just go by yourself. You don't have to go as a group to Cuba. So if you wanted
Mary.
If you wanted to go to Santiago and Guantanamo, we could help you set that up.
But I would want to go with you, Mary, because you're the guide. You're the Gandalf of the group.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Jared and I have a history. Yeah. I mean, it's something that we have to look at. We did decide not to do that this year because it wasn't practicable. And we're very late getting this going. I mean, ideally, we would have had this underway by July, but we didn't. Are there any other questions?
I don't mean to be rude. I'm looking at my cell phone right now, texting a bunch of people that might be interested in going. So I'm listening, but I'm also texting. You know, I've texted several state reps and former state reps.
Good. I used to. Do you remember Jarrett Barrios?
I don't think I served.
He was a state senator.
Yeah.
He had this project of taking primarily elected and appointed officials to Cuba on a book project to take books to a library in Cienfuegos. So quite a few people went on that over a period of 4 or 5 years.
So the other material we had to present is fundraising guidance. So for people that are, you know, that don't have the cash in hand and need to do some fundraising efforts, Mary has some stuff to present with some suggestions.
Claire has her hand up. And also, before we do that, we need to know if there's more questions.
Yeah, I was going to say, do we want to talk about the fundraising, or do we want to have just open discussion? How many people would like to hear the fundraising stuff tonight? One.
Well, if we do it at the end, whoever's not interested can get off.
Okay.
But Claire, did you have another question?
I more have another comment. Yeah. It's points to share. I mean, I think when we went on the trip, you had sent us all kinds of information about bring this, bring that. It's very important. Read that thoroughly and be sure to bring the things you're told to bring, including toilet paper. So some of the things we take for granted, believe me, they come in handy down there because of the infrastructure, you know, issues with infrastructure. You go to this place, it's like a special place. It's a beautiful building. You go to the bathroom, there's not even a toilet seat. So be prepared.
So we will have more info sessions for people who are signed up, and we will have all of that information. And I also want to say, related to toilet paper, that I spent most of 2020 in lockdown in Cuba. And I have to say, the whole neighborhood was laughing at y'all with your toilet paper issues. We really thought it was a hoot because we have little sprays. But anyway, We will cover all of that, you know, absolutely. And we'll have info sessions on any number of things. Brian.
Sorry, I was just struggling to get off mute. I went down with Witness for Peace, as many of you know, And one thing that almost all of us did was we checked a bag, and we just filled it with, and I'm sure you'll send this around too, you know, stuff that people need in Cuba because they can't get it because of the blockade. And toiletries is one of the things. So that I'm sure you have planned, you know, items to bring with you as donations as well, right?
Well, the way I usually do it is, yes, you can take individual gifts to people, but what I like to do is institution to institution. So as I said, when we went over the itinerary, we have a relationship with a school and we have a relationship with a polyclinic. And what I would like us to do is to take donations to that school. Last year, they gave us a list of what they needed, actually. And also the same with the family doctor office and the polyclinic. And that way, you're reaching a lot of people, a lot of people. And there's nothing more important than children getting school supplies and hospitals and clinics getting bandaging materials and things like colostomy bags and stuff like that that they can't get.
So I'd be interested to know if how many people here are thinking of going at this point. One person already paid their deposit. That person's thinking of going.
I've just recruited three people that are three people are seriously interested.
Great.
One of them is a state rep, Carol Doherty from Taunton.
Oh, she's wonderful. Yeah.
Yep, Carol.
Also, yeah, we work with her.
They can write to me. They can also write to me directly if they have questions.
Can you put your, I was going to connect them with Cole, but if you would rather I connect them with you, Mary, I can do that. It's, you know, if you just put me your email address or Cole, do you want me to connect them with you? How do you want me to do it?
Either is fine.
All right, I'll just connect them with you, Cole. What I'll do is I'm going to do a reply to the email that you sent me with the itinerary and then just say, hey, just take it from there. But I also asked Adam Scanlon. And, a couple other people. I asked my publisher of the newspaper. He wants to know about this. He's intrigued, you know, my local newspaper, the Sun Chronicle. Actually, HBO producer just responded to me as well. Sounds interesting. What's the project? So, a few emails.
So you might have them write to me and to Cole, since we have different areas of expertise. My expertise is on Cuba and Cole's is on, I don't know what, many things.
Yep, I guess. Yeah.
Is your email, Mary, on one of the emails from Cole?
I just put it in.
I put it in the chat.
All right, cool.
So there's also other state reps that we're going to be in touch with that I've sent before. And also there's some radio people and other people out here in Western Mass.
Okay.
So I think we can have a kind of interesting group. First group.
Michael, you have something?
So here's my question.
I want to go, but pardon? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, that was my hand up saying I'm definitely interested.
Oh, okay. That was the hand. Great.
Who would be a really Lydia Edwards would be really interesting to invite.
Mm-hmm. I think that would be great if she came.
And from the Boston City Council, Ruth C. Lejeune, who I predict will be the next mayor of Boston, would be.
Do you want to get in touch with Lydia Edwards, or do you want us to?
I bet Michael knows her better than we do.
I'm sorry, Cole.
I think you probably know Lydia better than we do.
I
know Ruth Z a little bit, but you may know her better.
That's right. Yeah, I can reach out to Lydia.
Yeah.
So on account of it's already 8:03, I can either put on the slideshow of fundraising guidance for everybody, or those who aren't interested can get off and everybody else can see it. What would you like to do?
Who would like to stay for the fundraising segment? Raise your hand. I already asked that question, didn't I? Mary Ellen is raising her hand, maybe for that. And Brian, you said you wanted it.
Okay, all here's right. What we'll do. Yeah. I'm going to start it, and if you don't want to be on it, you can just leave, and yep. We'll know that we're going to see you again.
Yeah. So we got 3 weeks to go to recruit for this trip, and so we are, you know, we appreciate everyone's help in reaching out. We'll be reaching out. I have it in mind that we're going to make a call maybe around October 1st. We have to talk about this and see whether we should expand beyond Massachusetts, but we're going to talk about that. We have a small committee that's working to plan the trip. Mary and I are on it, also Brian, and we have an intern named Graham who is coming on the trip but couldn't attend tonight. And if anyone really wants to get involved and help us with all those schemings, we welcome you to our committee. So please let me know.
And we will appreciate your doing outreach.
Yeah.
Because the success of this trip really depends on having not just the number of people, 24, but having a good group of people who are very interested in Cuba and in working together when we get back.
Yeah. And actually, our trip planners are meeting tomorrow at 5. If anyone isn't interested in joining us, get in touch with me. Paul, you have something?
I just wanted to ask Mary, is there a Google Doc or something that we can find out who has expressed interest, who has committed? Some people have mentioned to me that they're interested, but I don't know whether they've signed up in one way or another.
Well, yeah, we started to compile an outreach list, and it hasn't been worked on, I think, for a while.
Give those names in, Paul, and we'll keep a running list of the people that are expressing interest.
But along with emails, because otherwise it's not really useful to us.
Sure.
I have a question. I have a couple of friends, one of whom lives in Boston, but also lives in Panama. And she was interested tonight, but said she would prefer to fly there from Panama rather than...
Sure. Panamanian, yeah. Is it Copa that flies daily?
The second is someone I knew from the HIC board who lives in Costa Rica. She's retired, and we traveled to the Temple of Chichen Itza last spring at the equinox, and I was thinking of inviting her. Would that work?
Sure, why not?
Yeah, we're looking for people that are interested in social justice and that are part of our extended circles. You know, if it's somebody you know and work with, Michael, that's great.
Great.
I mean, but I also do want to be clear that my hope with this trip is that people come back wanting to work with MAPA in whatever capacity that they can. I don't mean that they become a core member and dedicate their lives, but wanting to work with MAPA and also wanting to work to change U.S. policy towards Cuba, because it's criminal, it's unjust, and it's unworthy of us as Americans. I spent 20 years sending people to Cuba who were not political delegations. They were state representatives. They were conservationists. They were university students. They were museum directors. And everybody came back saying that they wanted to, that they thought that the embargo, U.S. embargo, was criminal. And then our job was to give them something to do about it. And I both like sending just ordinary Americans who didn't necessarily have a commitment to the revolution next year. And I also like the fact that ordinary people would go and come back and want to do something. So that's my hope for, and anybody who fits in that, those two criteria, I will work like mad to make sure that they have a really, really good trip.
So Cole and Mary, I just emailed the both of you and with a bunch of other people that already expressed an interest, and I'm waiting on a bunch more. So, you know, try and get those numbers up. And these people seem like, you know, they're really interested. So
great.
I texted people who I knew would be like, yeah, I'm into that. So
I'll tell you, Paul, in 20 or 21, I can't remember which it was, We actually had a state rep and a state senator who were interested in submitting a resolution calling for an end to the punishing sanctions on Cuba. And that still is a worthy goal. There are city councils all over Massachusetts and all over the country that have done that. And that is a real contribution that can be made.
I asked Ty Waterman, he's a city councilor here in Attleboro, probably the most left-leaning city councilor. He's a former West Roxbury social worker. And so I haven't heard back from him yet. He's not very good with text message, but.
Has Boston City Council done that yet?
Yeah. Yes.
Yes, they passed it last year. And the person who led it is off the council, unfortunately.
Kendra.
I'm going to hop off the call. I'm going to go to get some dinner, but I am.
Great meeting you, Cole.
Yeah. So Cole and Mary.
Being with you in Cuba.
Yeah. Yeah. And I'll be able to, put down the deposits and everything, and I'll connect with Cole about make sure I get all that done on time. But, like I said, I'll try and recruit some more folks.
Great.
Paul, I have a question for you. A very quick one. You're very popular among my friends, and I mentioned to one of them that you might be going, and that was like, the frosting on the cake. Is it public knowledge? Can I tell other people? Because I think it would be a draw.
Yeah, you can tell them. I would keep it quiet until I return, because I don't want to deal with it. It's one of those, let's ask for forgiveness, not permission, because I don't want to deal with a headache before I go. I'm also trying to get into Iran right now. I've been trying since 2015. Yeah. And I've been rejected numerous times. One of these days, they're going to be like, all right, let's let this guy in here. So same thing, I'll let people know after I come back from that. I'm okay. You can use me as a draw if you want. That's fine. But I want to keep it on the down,
on the down low. Okay.
On the down low, not publicized like publicly, but it's, if it helps get the numbers up, sure.
Yeah. Okay. The magic number is 24, everybody.
Cool. All right, all. It was very nice to see some of you, and Paul Shannon, you and I have met somewhere. I can't remember where it is, but maybe we'll maybe it'll come to me eventually. I know we've met before.
Yeah, we did some stuff together at the State House for a while there, Paul.
Yeah, I know we've met. It was over 6 years ago I was there, so I knew I recognized you. I can't remember what the project was, but yeah. I'm gonna hop off and go to Garden.
Good to see you. Okay.
Good to see y'all. All right, thanks, Cole. All right, take care, guys. Bye.
So I would like to do the PowerPoint for whoever wants it. And then I have to take this jet lag person to bed because I will be awake at 2 a.m. Can we do that?
Yep.
Okay. Wait, let me find it. Wait a minute. Everybody, this is my first. This is my first Zoom PowerPoint. Slideshow. There we go. Look at this.
Wow.
I did this myself, everybody. So we can't fundraise for you, but we can give you ideas to spark your fundraising yourselves. And to me, the secret of fundraising, and I can't stand cold calling, but I love fundraising in groups. I really do. It's like giving a party. And if you think of it that way, and if you think of you're trying to connect with people and engage them and wanting to be a part of your success, then it's not as embarrassing as saying, will you help me? So that's my first premise, that people want to invest in you. They want you to be successful. And now how do I do the next slide? Oh. I just did it. So here's my first idea. So my daughter, who's half Cuban, she and I decided that we would take kids from her school to Cuba. So yes, they did car washes, which I'm not suggesting you do, but the most successful thing they did was a letter campaign. They wrote to all their relatives, all their friends, everybody they knew, and asked them for money. They said, if we can raise $1,000, we can go to Cuba. And they did. It was easy peasy. And what they did is they promised them something in return, which is emails from Havana, a special dinner party or with slides when they return, even a WhatsApp call from Havana. And then, wait a minute. Okay. So when you compose a letter, how am I going to do this without it? How do I make it go down so that you can see the rest of this? Can somebody tell me how to do that?
Maybe use your mouse.
My mouse is going to the next one.
Mm. What tool are you showing us? Is this PowerPoint or Word?
It's Google Slides.
I don't think you have to fix your slide because Google Slides shows you your whole slide. You wrote more than your slide can hold.
No, it's just too large.
Okay.
All right. Let me get out of this, and I've got another way to do it. Okay. So you can even bring them t-shirts or souvenirs, right? Then compose a letter, make it short, make it personal, and make it thrilling. You're going on a terrific adventure. You're going to a place that everyone knows is interesting, mysterious, hard to get to. Some see it as forbidden. You know they want you to succeed. Just approach it that way. And so you need their help to get there, and you're going to give them something when you get back. So what can they send you? Can they send you $500? Can they send you $50? Can they send you $25? Tell them how much you have to raise, which in this case is $2,500 or something like that. And make sure to tell them what they're going to get in return. You know, like, send me to Cuba, and when I get back, I'm going to brighten your life by doing a party or giving you a t-shirt or something. And then if you don't meet your goal with the first letter, don't be afraid to follow up. Let people know how much you've raised and how much more you need. Most people are going to give it to you because they're interested in you. Very few people are going to do it because you have lofty political goals. That's just something to keep in mind. And then be sure you write thank you letters, reiterating how important this trip is to you, what you're going to bring back, and so forth. That's letter writing, which is really my favorite way. Last year, I sent out letters. I was in Havana, and I sent out letters. And what did I raise, Cole? Something like $7,000 or more. And one of them came from somebody who just likes me and likes Cuba, so she decided to give us a lot of money. Another idea is, I'm calling it a raise the roof party, but it's like an old-fashioned rent party. Just throw a party. However you like to throw a party. Set a goal for how much you think you're going to raise. It's always good when you're fundraising to set a goal. You know, like if you think you can raise $500 at a party, or $350, or $1,000, set that goal, have it in your mind so that when you're building the party and when you're talking to people and asking for donations, you're upfront about what you need. And you're also clear that you don't expect them to be able to give it all, but just to give what they can. If you think that you have a crowd that'll go for it and you have something that you can auction or raffle off, do that. You could even raffle off a t-shirt that you're going to bring back from Cuba. If you have a sense of humor when you do these things, People just think it's a great way to give money. It's painless. Be careful not to invest more in food or drink than you think you can raise. You don't want to find that you're at break-even point. You want to make sure that you have not spent more than, say, 20% of what you're totally going to get. And then send people a thank you letter afterwards. And let them know how much you raised. People like to know that. Don't cook tonight. This is another favorite that I think we used to do a lot of, and I don't know that we do it so much anymore, but it's a good moneymaker to offer a home-cooked dinner, either Cuban food or whatever interesting cuisine you think you or someone you can count on can produce. Don't be afraid to enlist a friend. You don't have to cook it yourself. Also, if you need recipes for Cuban food, just write me and I'll send them to you. Then you send out notices to all the people you think might be interested. Don't forget people where you work or the organizations you were in. Take pre-orders so that you know how much to cook. And again, don't spend more than you think. In this case, don't spend more on food than 20% of what you're going to charge, since the goal is to make money. How are you going to know how much to charge? Because you're going to do what I do, is you go on Instacart or you go to the actual grocery store, you write down the quantities and everything, and you add up the amount of money it's going to cost you, remembering to include serving containers and cutlery. But it's a great way to raise money. Another idea is to throw a dinner party. It's like don't cook tonight, but people eat in. You don't have to have a table that can seat 12 people or 20 people. You just have to be able to have a buffet. And then you can charge maybe 35 a person, calculating again ahead of time the cost of the food that you're going to serve and the drink, and then making sure that you're going to make a profit. If your house isn't big enough, ask to use somebody else's. The key is not to spend more money than you think you can make. And then here are some other ideas, which are potentially less lucrative, but every small bit counts. Hold a Cuban movie night and charge admission. You can get lots of Cuban movies on Netflix or Amazon or Hulu. Organize an auction or a raffle. Organize a garage or a yard sale. These can easily make $200 or $300. You get to get rid of stuff you don't want, and then also you get to give a chance to your friends and relatives to get rid of stuff they don't want. So those are my ideas, just to get you started. And I'm prepared to give people advice. I'm prepared to add other ideas to this slideshow. Basically, I know there's always a concern that if people give money for this, they're not going to be giving money, for instance, to MAPA. I don't think that's the case, because they're two different things. One is a donation to a political project and an organization. This is a personal donation to you to do something that you want. And just as people have enough money to give to MAPA and also take you out for dinner sometimes or to the movies, they have enough money to give MAPA and also to help you with what you want to do. And that's it. Is that helpful?
Those are great ideas, wonderful ideas. I guess my interest is, well, first of all, I imagine that communications will send out an appeal as well for fundraising.
For money? No.
For money?
No. Absolutely not. MAPA, okay. MAPA is not going to fund this. Not at all. MAPA's not in a position to, and I don't think that it should.
Okay, I was confused about that. Got it.
Yeah.
Got it.
I just, that does take away from MAPA's potential donors to do that. And I feel very strongly about that. And I can say that because I'm talking to members of the board and the staff now.
Yeah. Because the one person who's the most interested is not in a position to pay for it, you know, for that, you have that kind of cash. And I actually thought, I said, I'm going to investigate, perhaps there's going to be scholarships or something. So I'm going to have to retract that.
Are they in a position to fundraise? Because I'm telling you, I had 12-year-old kids raising $1,000.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know.
Don't Cook Tonight is a great way to raise money.
He's a bachelor. I think that his, you know, most of his meals are probably takeout. But anyway, yeah.
Yeah. Maybe books.
No, no.
Anyway.
He's an only, everybody's dead. Anyway, okay, so I will, okay. Yeah.
Yuma, unfortunately, it's, I mean, end the embargo and maybe we can have cheap trips.
Yeah.
But, you know, in the situation that Cuba's in and that U.S. policy is in, it's just not feasible.
And the reason I was thinking of perhaps I was misunderstanding that MAPA would be putting part of the bill somehow, but because one of the names on the list of people to ask is Lahai. He currently, I think he still works for us.
Yeah, he does.
Part-time.
Yep.
And I don't know what his financial situation is. But, you know, that would be someone that, if he's interested, if someone like that is interested, a young person who, because as we know, we desperately need young people to get on the board, get on the bandwagon of Mass Peace Action. I was even wondering whether we wanted to ask any of our interns. And
yeah.
Similarly, you know, are they in a position?
You know, Marianne, I'll tell you, I'm actually kind of hard ass about this. And I like to quote Mel King when I used to go fundraising with him. He used to say, look at your sneakers. How much did you pay for those? I think that people, you know, there's price tags on everything. And it's true. There are people who don't have money and who ought to be able to go to Cuba. But we are not in a position to make that happen. But people are in a position to try to organize for the things that they want. They are in a position to do that. And if there's enough people who want this person to be able to go, then they can form a circle of friends around him and help make that happen. But I really don't think that MAPA is in a situation. I mean, I would rather see MAPA raise salaries to its people and to the interns before I'd like to see them fund people to go on a trip. And I really feel quite strongly about that. Brian has his hand up.
Well, I had the same question. My question was about scholarships, because I know people that would be good on the trip, you know, some of whom I went on the trip before with, but I think funds would be a serious issue. Like I'm thinking particularly of Virginia, who...
But how did she manage to go last time?
She emptied her savings, but she was going to, you know, see family that she had never seen before. And then that's somebody who, you know, that the reason why that Somerville city council resolution was unanimous was probably because of her testimony. But you know, it's a I would think that, you know, a certain maybe a couple of scholarships might not be a bad idea.
If you know? Have people who want to form a fundraising committee and raise that money, I'm all for it. I'm not going to be on that committee. I'm exhausted.
Yeah, fair enough. I mean, we could do a fundraising event or something.
I think if people want to form a fundraising committee to be able to send people, then that's the thing to do. I would just caution that I think that that takes money away from MAPA, and MAPA is not.
It does.
Right? Yeah. And I think that people who want to go, these are really valuable skills to learn, to be able to raise money, to be able to do what you want to do with your life. I mean, these are valuable skills to learn and to have. And it's a valuable experience to see if you can organize your personal friends, coworkers, and others around you to help you do it.
I'm going to go get my dinner, but...
Mary, something to chew over. We're going to talk tomorrow, right?
Mary, perhaps you can close up the Zoom.
No, I think we have to all leave, Cole. I
Okay. Adios.
All right, we can wrap then. If there's nothing
let's
else.
Wrap.
Yeah, we'll talk everybody. Tomorrow.
I still have to do my leg treatment, and I have to get to sleep sometime. Okay.
Anything else that needs to come up from anyone?
Nah, we're good.
We're good.
Okay.
Very good. Thank you, Mary.
Sorry to be hard ass about it, but boy, I am.
Okay. Bye now.
Bye.
Bye-bye.